problem with just saying America is Egypt is there is no context to the statement. Some people may have noticed a wave of America is Egypt information spreading across social media. And I can assure you, I've had nothing to do with that. Usually when you hear the information, it is very superficial and has very little depth to it. It makes it very easy for some pseudo-brainwashed historian to just say, America is not Egypt. Egypt is Egypt. And then they'll go on to recite insignificant facts that they learned about Egypt when they were spoon-fed up the rectum by some academic they trust. And now that spoonful has floated up the rectum and to the heart. So now they take it personal. How dare you say America is Egypt after all the bullshit I've learned? I've seen the pyramids, buddy. I've been there. That is definitely Egypt. You struck a nerve with their whole perception of ancient history, a subject they may have felt with some personal esteem. So it's only natural. They may be a little butthurt after all. They did loosen their loins to get that spoonful up there. And now you're telling them that spoonful was no good? You'd be mad too. As many people are the first time they realize all of the lies they've been butt-fed. Feedings aside, there is no legitimate reason to take their information as truth, considering the worlds of information hidden by these institutions of controlled academia unto this day. When someone pukishly says, America is not Egypt, understand they have become shills for the establishment, according to them in their position. All history confirming their position must be completely true. They are locked in to the terms of their silent agreement with the works of evil men. Agents of the beast will gladly stand on the blood of the righteous and wave the flag for the works of those evil men if it validates their position. Especially if it doesn't require the work necessary to develop their own nuanced opinion about a certain subject. To completely grasp this subject matter, the superficial history of ancient Egypt that has been propagandized will not do, because that narrative, as we have learned thus far, is completely full of holes. Whether it's the construction of the pyramids, the chronology of Egyptian dynasties, the Crusades, or the discovery of the pyramids by Napoleon, their version of Egyptian history is completely inconsistent. A significant problem with just saying the statement America is not Egypt is the fact that that statement alone literally denies the pre-Columbian antiquity or scale of American civilizations, many of which predate, were larger than Egypt, and who practiced the same traditions and customs that were exclusively attributed to Egypt. In an earlier episode, we highlighted the Upper Mississippi Basin, specifically the areas around St. Louis, Mound City, and Cahokia. We even spoke to Harry Hubbard about his amazing discovery of the tombs of Cleopatra, Mark Antony, and Alexander the Great in Illinois. In this episode, we detail the lost civilizations of the Middle and Lower Mississippi. In the first episode, we addressed the Mississippi River and its relationship to the great river from the Bible, not the Nile, but the Euphrates. We also showed how the Nile in Africa does not fit the biblical description of the great river, but the Mississippi fits perfectly. Furthermore, we examined the etymology behind the word and defined the word Nile as a Greek improper noun, which means tributary, creek, or stream, and not the proper name of a river, as assumed by most people. In the episode, we concentrated our search around the vicinity of Mound City, which was essentially destroyed to build the city of St. Louis. We also investigated the significance behind the name of St. Louis and showed the relationship between King Louis IX, St. Louis, and their connection with Egypt during the Crusades. In this episode, we dig deeper into Louisiana territory, specifically the lower Mississippi region south of Memphis, Tennessee, which seems like a good place to start. According to the classical narrative, Memphis was the capital of Lower Egypt, but also its most northern city, which symbolically recognized the union between the two kingdoms, Upper and Lower Egypt. The city of Memphis, Tennessee, was another major U.S. city built upon an ancient American civilization, just like St. Louis. The city of Memphis has remnants all over the city, not just in the outskirts, even downtown. Chickasaw Heritage Park was at one time a Chickasaw fortress, but was conquered by the French in the early 1700s and renamed Fort Assumption. The Tennessee Encyclopedia states that over 2,400 blacks and Indians fought with the French during their takeover of Chickasaw Fort. One would wonder, how did the French find so many cooperative blacks and Indians to fight the Chickasaw a half century before the apex of the North American slave trade? How could all those so-called blacks fighting for the French have been African if there were barely any so-called Africans on the continent at the time? And the few that were there were in Virginia. Something to think about. Another thing to think about is how Memphis has always been one of the historically blackest cities in America. It should come as no surprise that most of the people who hail from Memphis are indeed related and are ancestors of the conquered Chickasaw Nation, who over the time following assimilated into French culture prior to 1820 and American culture afterwards. The historically black neighborhood of Orange Mound in Memphis apparently got its name from the orange shrubs on the former Diedrich plantation. Not a mound, apparently. Surprised they didn't just call it Orange Bush, if that was the case. But these aren't the only mounds built over by the city of Memphis. The Chukalissa mounds lie just to the south on the east side of the river. They were discovered during the construction of Shelbytown Negro Park in the 1930s. This mound complex has been attributed to the Middle Mississippian culture that extended up to Cahokia and throughout the Mississippi region, demonstrating a relationship that spread just as far. Yet the issue, as is the case with Big Mound or Mound City St. Louis, the current city essentially destroyed any areas that could now be studied by modern archaeologists. And as is the case across the Mississippi region, the French are hiding its secrets.
Trying to make it better. You respect the man, or you get to black and sweat.
directly across the river in and around West Memphis, are said to be some of the oldest mound sites on the continent. The location of these mound complexes are on the opposite side of the river, parallel to the layout of St. Louis, where both Big Mound and Mound City were destroyed to build the cities of St. Louis and East St. Louis, also two other historically black cities. Likewise to Memphis and West Memphis, the only difference being that the larger cities are on opposite sides of the river. We must not forget King Louis IX is the only French king to ever be sanctified or turned into a saint. What is that, sanctified? St. Louis being the gateway to the west, built on the west side of the river, Memphis on the east, and both of these Egyptian cities have large indigenous so-called black populations whose families have been living there long before French colonization. And of course, from Big River Park in West Memphis, you got a perfect view of the large pyramid on the other side, a pyramid which has no historical significance or connection to ancient Egypt. And any assertion otherwise is pure conspiracy. Jeez, guys. You can just put a pyramid somewhere. It doesn't mean anything, all right? Did you know the city of Memphis, Egypt, was supposedly abandoned over 1,000 years ago, and now an insignificant small town sits atop the ruins of the once great capital of ancient Egypt? Who knows what is behind the Egyptian philosophy of what to preserve and what to destroy? Because apparently nothing in Memphis was worth keeping. But what they did do, as stated by the top Egyptologists and historians, is use the ruins of Memphis to build Cairo on the other side of the river. In reality, Memphis, Egypt hasn't even been a thing for over 1,000 years. And the last time Memphis, Egypt was popping, according to the scholars, Memphis, Tennessee was definitely popping and connected to a much larger kingdom that dwarfed the desert. And it wouldn't matter if there was a section of Memphis, Tennessee called Egypt or Egyptian-themed streets and names throughout the city. There is no connection between Memphis, Tennessee and the ancient, non-existent Memphis, Egypt. Remember that when you're seeing all of these renditions. Hey, this is an art. This is what Memphis looked like. The palace was white. We know this. We know that. Memphis literally doesn't exist. Yet Giza existed. Giza's still standing, but Memphis doesn't exist anymore. When was the statue of Ramses discovered in Memphis?
1820. According to Wikipedia, the statue of Ramses II is a 3,200-year-old figure of Ramses II, depicting him standing. It was discovered in 1820 by Giovanni Battista Caviglia at the Great Temple of Ptah near Memphis, Egypt.
And all of this is just a coincidence. Besides, Memphis, Tennessee was named in 1819, during a time when niggas didn't even know about Memphis, Egypt. Oh, they didn't, did they? I typed Memphis, Egypt into Google, and Egypt, Memphis, Tennessee popped up. As a matter of fact, Google can't seem to find Memphis, Egypt. They say Memphis was abandoned, and many of the building materials were used to build Cairo. It's important to understand that Cairo, Egypt is not technically an ancient city. If anything, it is another city built over an even older city. Cairo, Egypt, as we know it, was built as a Byzantine Roman city during the Roman era and later fell into the hands of the Muslims. The oldest structures in the city are Byzantine Coptic churches, supposedly built in the mid to late 300s during the transition of Rome into Christianity. This means the Romans aka the Italians, French, Spanish, Germans, a whole bunch of niggas, they've been in Egypt since the 300s. How far are these churches from the pyramids? They've been in Egypt since 300. But they didn't know shit about the pyramids? Another interesting point is that the city of Memphis, Egypt, was supposedly built by Pharaoh Menes, aka Narmer of the First Dynasty, the pharaoh whose picture is on the Narmer Stele. Of course, we remember that the Narmer Stele is literally identical with several depictions from the Mesoamerican, Mendoza, and Florentine Codex. The supposed Memphis from the ancient Egyptian dynastic period was, according to the scribes, taken by the Persians in 525 BC, conquered again in 332 BC by Alexander. After his death, it was partitioned into the hands of the Ptolemies until becoming a Roman city following the saga of Cleopatra and Mark Antony. After that, it became a Christian city. That was until the Christians were conquered by the Muslims, and it became a Muslim city. And that was until the Crusades, when the area changed hands back and forth between Romans and Ottomans. Despite all of this history that is documented by academia regarding the occurrences at the time, not one person in Egypt, Persia, Greece, Babylon, or Rome could decipher one hieroglyphic. Until 1,000 years later, when Napoleon invades Egypt in 1800. So the French could not have known about Memphis, Egypt before they colonized Memphis, Tennessee. If the French were in Memphis, Tennessee in the 1600s, does it really matter if Memphis wasn't given its name until 1819? The official narrative is that the city is named after the ancient city of Memphis, Egypt. But nobody knew about Memphis in 1819. Campolian didn't even produce his breakthrough decipherment of the Rosetta Stone until 1822, and he is considered the father of Egyptology. So the idea that the city of Memphis, Tennessee was named after Memphis, Egypt is a gargantuan cap. Furthermore, the entire narrative we've been given about this subject matter is a gargantuan cap, reeking of a false historical propaganda psyop perpetuated to the public on behalf of many key players with Freemasonic ties for the purposes of deceiving the world. And some touched soul will still ask the question, well, why would they lie to us about history? Bless your heart. Bless your heart. Which river was more profitable for the French, the Mississippi or the Nile? As I have mentioned earlier, the Nile has two natural tributaries, the White Nile and the Blue Nile. The headwaters for the Blue Nile start in Ethiopia at Lake Tana. This lake is actually almost a mile above sea level. From that point, the water flows down north into the Mediterranean. The White Nile starts somewhere near Lake Victoria, another body of water that is in the highlands. So the headwaters for the White Nile start around Lake Albert, Uganda, somewhere near Lake Victoria. And then, of course, gravity makes the water flow downhill through the rest of Egypt out to the Mediterranean Sea. The Nile is approximately 4,100 miles long. Most people say it's the longest river in the world. However, there has been a little bit of pushback. Some people actually say it's the Amazon. Well, the Nile is navigable for approximately 500 to 600 miles, according to most navigational charts, from the Mediterranean Sea to the Aswan Dam. And this is where you meet the cataracts of the Nile. Cataracts of the Nile are places on the Nile where the water is too rocky for large vessels to be able to navigate. The average depth, however, of the Nile is almost twice as deep as the Mississippi. The Nile average is about 25 to 35 feet deep. The Aswan Dam, when it was constructed, they had to move Abu Simbel in order to build the dam because they didn't want to lose all of those quote unquote ancient monuments to the water. So the Aswan Dam is what we would call the first cataract, which means that's as far as boats could navigate. The Aswan Quarry is where they got the granite and then shipped it up the Nile in order to build the pyramids. Whether you believe that or not, that's the narrative. There are a few cataracts that are actually near some of these ancient sites, especially the Tombo site and the Moro site in Sudan are both cataracts of the Nile, which means at each one of these locations, these are points where the water gets rocky and boats can't pass. And apparently this is where they would build their civilizations on the cataracts. The climate around the Nile is pretty consistent. Desert, arid temperatures is the entire territory from which the Nile flows. I've seen this picture being used a lot. This is the Tennessee Centennial and International Exposition in 1897, where the city of Memphis built a large pyramid in its exhibit. So I know there was a lot of rumor about this actually being in Memphis. It turns out, according to the information we're reading here, that this pyramid exposition was actually in Nashville. And you see the Parthenon building beside the pyramid. And for those of you who are familiar with these centennial fairs, these world fairs, these centennial expositions, they claim to build all of these unique buildings out of just plaster, and they can easily be broken down. And some people have said that there are actually buildings that were old world buildings that were part of expositions before being torn down. But apparently, this pyramid was not in Memphis, although the city of Memphis featured a large pyramid as part of their exhibition. The total attendance was 1.7 million people. That was a lot of people for 1897, especially.
Well, the reason, okay? The reason that they named this place Memphis is because it reminded them of Memphis, Egypt.
Oh yeah, Memphis. Yeah, that reminded me. You know what? This place reminds me of the place that Pharaoh Menes. Yeah, it was Pharaoh Menes. I've been reading old Egyptian books. Listen, I knew about Egypt before Napoleon and his boys. See, this place reminds me of the, you remember Pharaoh Menes from the old Egyptian stories that we used to read with our parents? Yeah, Pharaoh Menes. Yeah, you remember he started a city because he wanted to unite Upper and Lower Egypt. Do me wrong. I don't want to call BS, but what do these assholes know about Memphis, Egypt?
So now we'll compare the Nile to the Mississippi. One of the first glaring differences is the amount of tributaries that are on the Mississippi as opposed to the Nile. As I mentioned earlier, the Nile has only two natural tributaries, where the Mississippi has too many to count. Some of the most notable tributaries, starting from the south, are the Red River, which begins at the 100th meridian, and the average depth of the Red River is about 10 to 40 feet. For the longest time, the Red River wasn't navigable by boat because of what they call the Great Raft. The Great Raft in Louisiana was a logjam where trees basically cut off any passage through the river. There was a guy who actually, I forget the guy's name, I think it's the guy whoever Shreveport, Louisiana is named after. I think he actually invented some sort of boat or barge that was designed to move trees out of the way. So apparently it took several decades for them to clear this logjam so vessels could pass the Red River.
the navigational possibilities at the Gulf of Mexico are obviously endless. Because once you hit open sea, you can pretty much go anywhere in the world. So that basically is what I mean by the determination of what we would call navigability. Title 33 of the U.S. Code and 33 CFR define the navigable waters of the United States and apply certain laws and regulations to those waters, including the principle of navigable servitude. The principle of navigable servitude? Holy shit. This determination is made by a combination of waters explicitly listed in the law and general definitions that mean certain waters might or might not be included depending on various factual determinations, such as being navigable in fact and the history of use. And I think that's interesting here, and the history of use by the Army Corps of Engineers. Not all waters have had these facts determined, and so are of uncertain status. All water subject to tides are included. Note that the Navigable Waters Act of the United States listed in 33 CFR 329 are different than those listed as Waters of the United States, CFR 328, which is the Clean Water Rule. However, all navigable waters, plus those considered navigable in fact, are included in the general waters definition. So from this, it seems like there are two different kinds of waters. You have navigable waters and general waters, and depending on their history of use is how their status is determined, from what I can ascertain from reading this short snippet here. Another major tributary of the Mississippi is the Arkansas River. This river is 1,400 miles, and its headwaters begin in Colorado. Where the headwaters begin in Colorado, there is almost a 5,000 foot drop in a span of 120 miles. So obviously that part of the river isn't navigable. It's navigable for about 440 miles. Most navigation is controlled by dams and locks. When they built dams in order to contain enough water for vessels to pass through. So now we have dams and locks that control the water table to ensure that certain size vessels can pass through. So apparently the Arkansas River is navigable for large vessels all the way to Tulsa, Oklahoma. And of course, most of that water depth is controlled by dams and locks. In relationship to ancient times, most of this river was navigable up until this point for any relatively small size vessel. The navigability in today's terminology mostly includes commercial shipping. Another major tributary of the Mississippi is the Illinois River. The Illinois River is probably the shortest rivers in terms of being considered a major tributary of the Mississippi. Also, it's not really navigable with large commercial shipping. However, it most likely was navigable for small vessels back during ancient times. The water depth average is only from 2 to 5 feet, so it's not really made for large ships to be able to pass through. We mentioned this in an earlier episode. The Illinois River has been artificially connected to the Great Lakes through the Illinois-Michigan Canal System. So basically, they wanted commercial shipping from the Great Lakes to connect to the Mississippi River. They did that because there's no natural course from the Great Lakes to the Mississippi, although the Mississippi drainage basin goes all the way up into the border of the Great Lakes. So at some point, they decide to build a canal from Chicago, connecting the Chicago River to the Illinois River. And of course, there was a massive shitstorm, literally. Because when they tried to connect these two water systems, they actually reversed the flow of water coming from the river. There was a major sewage backup. So the river was basically flooded with shit. And between Peoria, Illinois, and Chicago, unto this day, there are several sewage problems as a result of them trying to connect two water systems that shouldn't be connected. If God wanted the Mississippi water basin to touch the Great Lakes water basin, he would have made it occur naturally. So there's absolutely a reason why the Mississippi doesn't connect to the Great Lakes. Those waters are not supposed to mix together. Now there's an invasive species, the Asian carp that jump out the water and knock your head off. They have invaded the Mississippi. And the only way that they can get into the Great Lakes is through the shitty Chicago canal system. So that's the only way they can even have access to the Great Lakes. So they've had to install all of these electroshock devices within the water to execute fish so they do not invade the Great Lakes. And that's mainly because these waters should never intersect with one another. The Mississippi watershed is a totally different water than the Great Lakes watershed. Something to keep in mind, that these two watersheds naturally border each other, but at no point do they cross. And the only way that they were able to cross is through an artificial canal system that at this point is fucking the environment up. So just like I said, if the creator wanted those waters to mix, he would have made them flow into each other naturally. You're essentially trying to marry two ecosystems together with the hope that you can make that a commercial enterprise. And that commercial enterprise is a river of shit. Continuing, another major tributary of the Mississippi River is the Missouri River. And the Missouri River is actually longer than the Mississippi. The Missouri is actually navigable for 730 miles to Sioux City, Iowa. And on the other side, it's navigable from Great Falls, Montana to approximately the North Dakota state line. So you can take the Mississippi all the way up to St. Louis, bust a left on the Missouri, and take that all the way to Sioux City, about 730 miles, which means from Sioux City, you can ship pretty much anywhere on Earth. And we can see that the river goes all the way into Montana past Bismarck, North Dakota. And you'll notice that a lot of these cities are actually situated on rivers, of course. And they say that it's navigable all the way to the North Dakota line, and possibly throughout the Dakotas, there may be parts that are navigable. From Montana, it flows all the way to the Mississippi. There are a few major cities on the Missouri River, most notably St. Louis at the confluence, then Kansas City, and then Omaha, Nebraska, and then Sioux City. And once you get past Sioux City, of course, it's not as easily navigable, but also the cities get smaller. You're up in the Dakotas. So the expansion of the West via the Missouri couldn't really go any further west than Sioux City on a vessel. At that point, you just got to get out and hump it. It travels through some of the most unpopulated and expansive parts of the country. If the river was navigable from Montana to Nebraska, then there would be a lot more people in those areas. Breaking down some reaper, rolling up a sweet dog, riding through the street dog, cheating like a heater, reaper got me missile, all they go to blue boy, searching back the echo, breath smell like liquor, man is project cutter, play up from the six out, always pack the decker, go deep in my miss out, hustle for the chitter, try not nip it fitter, you respect a man or you get some lucky sweater. The Builders of the Pyramid, the story of Shelby County. Quote, the Aborigines. Apply a carpenter's square to the extreme southwestern corner of the map of Tennessee so as to cut off a little piece of the state in the shape of almost a perfect square, and the territory of Shelby County is geographically located. On the north and the east, it lies in the arms of its sister counties of Tipton and Fayette. On the south, the great state of Mississippi serves as its footstool, while the waves of the lordly Father of Waters bathe its entire western boundary. It is a goodly tract of land, well-watered and heavily wooded, with valuable timber. The surface of this country is undulating, rising into many hillsides, falling into rich bottom lands. Wolf River, with its tributaries, breaks through the southern portion of the eastern line and flows westward and northward. Hatchie River rolls into the county from the northeast and sends its limpid waters to join the tawny waves of the Wolf just before the double current empties into the mighty Mississippi.
More than 1,000 years ago, the site of Shelby County was occupied by a race of men who have left many traces of their occupancy for the conjectures of posterity, but of whom little is definitely known. This race, the prehistoric mound builders, was certainly at one time in possession of this section of the country. Their mounds are found throughout the region, and one of the noblest of them crowns the high Chickasaw Bluffs that stand as sentinels for the land against the mighty current of the Broad River. So they've already told you, and they're telling you now, that this place, Shelby County, where Memphis is located, has been inhabited for thousands of years. And the most current people to inhabit the land were the Chickasaw. And the city is placed upon the Chickasaw Bluffs. The location of this mound is picturesque and grand. If it served as a signal station to this long ago extinct race, it could not have been better placed. If only used as a tomb, those who were buried beneath its huge weight may well have been mighty men. For excepting the pyramids of Egypt and other mounds of similar kind, no mausoleum rears a more stupendous bulk to the stars. The students of archaeology and the curiously inclined have spent much time and money digging into the bowels of these hillocks to find only a few bones mingled with earthenware utensils and occasionally, according to Ignatius Donnelly and others, both stone and copper implements of warfare. If this be true, does the discovery of these copper implements throw a flashlight of great interest upon that remarkable jump from the age of stone to the age of bronze attributed to the races of Europe? If indeed these mound builders were workers in copper, it is evident that with them, at least, there was a copper age between the age of stone and that of bronze. And as no copper cult is found among the prehistoric races of Europe, it might well be that in those early times, the mound builders, having observed the properties of this metal, invented bronze and introduced it as a thing completed to the dwellers of the Eastern Hemisphere. That is a thing they say about indigenous Americans, is that they did not have the ability to smelt heavy metals. They couldn't smelt anything. Of course, we know that's a lie. Continuing, this theory requires no strain upon intelligence than the hypothesis of archaeologists, who would have us believe that, with a bound, European races proceeded from stone to bronze. Bronze is composed of copper and tin, and it is necessary to believe that a knowledge of one of these metals antedated the invention of bronze, yet no utensil implement of copper or tin is found among the early peoples of Europe. If they are found in the tombs of the American mound builders, it is surely a reasonable hypothesis that these people perfected the invention of bronze while the Europeans were mere bearers and users of stone. The same ingenious delver into the almost impenetrable past finds so strong a resemblance between the mounds and the cult of the mound builders and the pyramids of Egypt and the habits of Egyptians that he does not hesitate to declare a close affinity between the two peoples, giving the advantage of age to the American branch. End quote. Builders of the Pyramid, story of Shelby County.
We ain't make those anchors, we ain't plot those gray sights. Up since daylight, burdened by the things we try to make right. It's gonna be a late night, so much turmoil makes my blood boil. Kundalini, encore, earth is unbroiled, dirt is unsore. With one chord, tell a story that some spoil. Watch it unfold, stories untold. Copyright unsold, books with one spine, ghosts with one soul. They want control, you want control, we share one goal. Fight one foe, satchel front door, and it keeps knocking, but the people kept rocking, yeah. And it keeps knocking, but the people kept rocking, yeah. Stop.
In my opinion, I think the most significant tributary of the Mississippi is the Ohio River. So the Ohio River is 981 miles. However, it's extremely navigable. You can navigate all the way from the confluence at Cairo, Illinois, to Louisville, what they call the Falls of Ohio. And on the other side of Louisville, you can navigate all the way to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Something to think about. The commercial capability of shipping on the Ohio River basically built the West. From Louisville, Kentucky, you could essentially take the Ohio River all the way to the confluence at Cairo, Illinois, and then ride the river to multiple places. You could take it to Tulsa, you could take it to Sioux Falls, Iowa, you could jump on the Red River. So there are several options from the Ohio River that during the expansion west that people were able to load up on a boat just in Louisville and ride the river all the way to other places in the country. The average depth of the river is 24 feet, and the total descent from Pittsburgh to Cairo, Illinois, which essentially is sea level for the river once it reaches the Mississippi, the descent is only about 430 feet, which means there are no massive changes in elevation. And as a matter of fact, the only rapids that you come into were the Falls of Ohio. But with that being said, you're still able to take the river several hundred miles inland, get out of the boat, and jump on the other side of the falls and still take it another several hundred miles to Pittsburgh. And that's why so many of the larger cities in this area were built on the Ohio River. Cities like Louisville, Kentucky, Cincinnati, Ohio, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and several in between of lesser note. So this is just a short explanation of the navigability of the Mississippi. Because when most people think of the Mississippi River, they just think of the main channel, but that's not actually how rivers work. All of those tributaries are part of a much larger river system. So you'll notice here on the map of navigable rivers in the United States how out west there are no navigable rivers. The Colorado is one of the most major rivers in the country. It is not navigable for anyone who's ever seen the Colorado. You know, you can't even walk through it in some parts, much less be able to take a large vessel because it's a mountainous river. Literally flows through the Rockies and flows through the canyons. And of course, it's been around for 50 million years, according to the top charlatan. The Colorado is not navigable. So the only true navigable waters on the west side of the country are the American River, which has been dredged for commercial traffic, and also the Columbia River up in Oregon, which has also been dredged for commercial traffic. So on one end of the Columbia River, you can take it all the way to Astoria, Oregon, and then you got to get out and hump it. And then you can also ride it again to Lewiston, Idaho. But in both cases, these waters aren't extremely navigable to anywhere else. The interesting thing about the Columbia River is it seems as though the basin of the Columbia River actually borders the basin of the Missouri River. So we know that the Missouri goes all the way west to Montana, which Idaho borders Montana, and that is pretty much the extent of the water basin of the Columbia River. I had a friend bring it up to me a while back that Lewis and Clark had actually found a way that the Columbia River system connected to the Mississippi. Although we don't see it now, that would have changed the world in terms of boating and travel for the rest of the country. If there was a way to clearly navigate from the Mississippi to the Columbia River, then all of those places out west, the wide expanses of the west that have been undeveloped and to this day would have been developed, and most likely there would have been cities all along those river lines. But since you couldn't easily travel that river or those rivers up in that area, and they couldn't connect to the Mississippi or much larger bodies of water on the inland continent, those areas just never really got developed. So the main upper channel of the Mississippi is navigable all the way to the Minneapolis-St. Paul area in Minnesota before you reach the falls. So the navigability of the Mississippi far supersedes the Nile today and in ancient times. Although the Nile may actually have an average depth that's twice as deep as the Mississippi is far more navigable
than the Nile. If the water is deep enough, you can put any size vessel in the water. Memphis has been a fun stop, but we got to keep it rolling down the river because there are more explorations and discoveries just to the south. Next stop, Natchez territory. The Natchez people had traditions and customs that could easily be related to what we would deem as Egyptian. But of course, they were doing this long before anyone had studied or known the customs of ancient Egypt. There are several mound sites throughout Natchez Indian territory, but naming just a few. Owl Creek mounds include five platform mounds archaeologists say were for ceremonial purposes, located at the edge of Choctaw territory, about 100 miles east of the river. This was as probably far east as the Natchez ended up after the French ran them out of their original territory. Glass Mound, outside of Vicksburg, Mississippi, had four pyramid mounds, also with accompanying ramps. In addition to this, artifacts within the mound are similar to others found within a 500-mile radius. These artifacts, just like the pyramids and ramps, have an uncanny likeness to the Maya. Winterville Mounds is a large mound complex built on the banks of the Mississippi River. There were at least 24 mounds originally, and possibly more. Again, archaeologists date the construction of this complex to no earlier than 11 AD, which means it fits the chronological timetable for all the other mounds along the river categorized as Mississippian. Mound A at Winterville was 55 feet tall, making it one of the tallest mounds in North America. A person could only imagine the amount of labor that went into the creation of these mounds, but according to the archaeologists, they were only occupied for a short amount of time. Chronologically, it seems like they have all the answers, and there is universal agreement across academia on these established timetables. All of these civilizations, every last one from Arizona to Mississippi, magically disappeared 50 years before Europeans arrived. Wow! It's amazing how all of these civilizations just up and disappear immediately before the arrival of Europeans. Since it can't be blamed on smallpox, which was really Salmonella, what happened to cause numerous empires separated by thousands of miles to dissipate at the same damn time? The same goes for Emerald Mound, another archaeological gold mine on the Mississippi side of the river, about 150 miles south of Winterville. Emerald Mound is said to be the second largest mound on the continent. Only the mound at Cahokia is said to be bigger. Emerald Mound covers 8 acres and is 770 feet by 435 feet with a height of 35 feet tall. According to the Adams County, Mississippi Genealogical and Historical Research Society, the Emerald site was abandoned during the French invasion, but the Natchez Indians still populated the proximity in more dispersed villages and continued to use nearby mound sites for their ceremonies. Just to the west of the Mississippi line is the 100th Meridian. So another aspect of the Mississippi that makes it so important to not just ancient times, but civilization, is the fact that it actually runs through multiple climates. The 100th Meridian, it's a line that goes straight down through the middle of the United States. The 100th Meridian is significant because it is a dividing point for multiple climates within the United States. And anyone who's ever driven across the country, if you've driven from east to west or from west to east, it's obvious. The West is arid and dry, and the East is wet and abundant. According to the Köppen climate scale, there are multiple climactic regions that the Mississippi encompasses. The dry, arid region of the West, to humid continental, to humid subtropical. Now, when we compare this to the Nile is just in the desert. Because the Mississippi runs parallel to the 100th Meridian, and you'll notice that most of these rivers are navigable till about the 100th Meridian. And that's really where the climate changes. So we can see the effect that climate and terrain have on the navigability of certain rivers. And furthermore, we can see the significance of the location of the Mississippi River between an arid, dry region just to the west, humid subtropical region to the southeast, and we have the humid continental to the northeast. These climate regions are not just arbitrary, they're also connected to genetics. People are genetically in tune to live in certain areas on Earth. For example, the mass migration of Europeans during colonialism. Anywhere in the Southeast, it was almost too hot for Black people to work out there. It would have killed white people because they are not genetically fit to live in certain areas. Taking that theory a step further, they are more genetically fit to live in Europe, just like Siberians are more genetically fit to live in the snow. That's why they have light skin and straight hair. All of those characteristics are genetic markers to indicate the climate that these people naturally fit. The real comparison isn't just the navigability of the waters, which we can see clearly that the Mississippi has far more navigational capability than does the Nile, but also the Mississippi acts as a border between multiple climatic regions, which also means it acts as a border between multiple genetic regions. There have been several theories about who constructed the mounds. The most popular theory among academics is that they were built by a vanished race of people. Southern Indian Studies, Volume 22, October 1970. Quote, "The most famous source of the 19th century that promoted the theory that the earthworks of the United States were constructed by a vanished civilization was the first volume of the Smithsonian Contributions to Knowledge." Oh, the ancient monuments of the Mississippi Valley. So the idea that there was a vanished race that no longer exists who built the mounds was first propagated by the Smithsonian, of course. The authors concluded from the evidence they examined that the earthworks could not have been constructed by the Indians or their ancestors. Squire and Davis, 1848-1842. Although this history has been posited by previous writers, it now gained a broader following because it had been printed in an official government book. See how they do? For the next half century, this theory was held by all but a few serious investigators. So what are they doing? They are creating the dogma through their institutionalized books, because the Smithsonian technically is a government institution. So it can set the parameters or the template by which all people are going to learn and look at history. The preceding paragraphs have attempted to show the development of the theory which explained the presence of thousands of earthworks in the eastern United States by referring them to a vanished civilization, much superior to the Indians who occupied the land during the period of white settlement. The proponents of this theory offered abundant but often conflicting evidence to support this theory. The claims presented below were taken from a number of sources. The list does not reflect the position of any single writer, but rather reflects the range of evidence used by partisans
of the vanished race theory to support their theory. So here's just a short list of things that the scholars used to disqualify the Indians as the builders of the mounds. Number one, the mounds were of great antiquity and therefore could not be the work of Indians. Also, before going forward, understand that the idea of an Indian has already been changed within the minds of these people. So that's part of the vanished race theory, is because the people who we call Indians today, who are really Siberians, those people don't genetically match the people who are excavated from the mounds. And the reason why they keep using this vanished race theory, we all know that it is founded in racism. Because if they tell you who's really in those mounds, then history changes forever. Number one, the mounds were of great antiquity and therefore could not be the work of Indians. Number two, the works show engineering and uniformity beyond the competence of Indians. Number three, the mounds served religious purposes, as did the high places of the Old Testament. Number four, the inscriptions at Grave Creek and other stone tablets prove that the mound builders had writing, a skill not possessed by the Indians. Five, no mounds were known to have been built by historic tribes. Six, the presence of the elephant effigy mound in Wisconsin, the Davenport elephant pipes, the gas tablets found in Iowa indicated great antiquity and perhaps the use of elephants in the construction of mounds. Seven, the presence of copper, bronze, brass, and iron implements indicated that the mounds belonged to a vanished race because Indians had no knowledge of metallurgy. Eight, the technical level and aesthetic refinement of the mound builder artifacts far surpassed the competence and sensitivity of Indians. And of course, this is always an ongoing theme. When any scholar mentions the Indians, they are savages and, of course, unintelligent. Number nine, the uniformity of mound forms over such a wide distribution was evidence of a central government, a phenomenon unknown among the Indians. Number 10, such works must have been based on a highly developed agricultural base. Such economy was not known for the Indians in the Midwest during historic times. Consequently, Indians could not have been responsible for such grand developments. So these are the theories posited by all the official academics as to why the Indians could not have built the mounds. End quote. Southern Indian Studies, Volume 22, October 1970. End quote. Continuing south and traveling through the Mississippi Delta on the east, Louisiana on the west, and going south to the Gulf of Mexico, there are so many mound complexes, it really don't make no sense, dog. Literally thousands have been documented, and even more have been lost to the floods of the Great River, destroyed by the infamous white man, or still remain uncovered unto this day. This region has always had a thriving population, going back thousands of years during the earliest times in the recorded civilization of man. There is no doubt this area has been home for a significant number of people since the days attributed to ancient Egypt. And the surprising part is that even the archaeologists agree, which is wild. They must not have figured it out yet. There is an abundance of evidence in the lower Mississippi region, and listing a few sites won't truly give the proper scale of just how many sites there are within just a few miles from the banks of the Mississippi on both sides of the river. A few of these sites include King's Crossing, the Prado Mounds, Aden Mounds, Ghost Site Mounds, Mazique Mounds, Peck Mounds, Rathman Mounds, Transylvania Mounds, Mott Mounds, Plum Bayou, and Troyville Mounds. This is just a limited few. And it doesn't include sites that are said to be some of the oldest and most significant sites on the continent and in the world. Mm-hmm. When we compare the position of Memphis, Tennessee on the Mississippi River to Memphis, Egypt's location on the Nile, a few undeniable similarities pop up. For one, ancient Memphis is said to be the city that united Upper and Lower Egypt due to its unique location on the Nile, which was north of Upper Egypt and south of Lower Egypt. Ironically, Memphis, Tennessee plays the exact same role in its location on the Mississippi. South of St. Louis would be considered the Upper Mississippi, and north of the Delta and New Orleans, which would be considered the Lower Mississippi. The only difference being that the Mississippi flows south into the Gulf of Mexico, aka the Egyptian Sea, and the Nile flows north into the Mediterranean Sea. But for some reason, the north is called Lower and the south is called Upper. The charlatans say it's because it's where the flow of the Nile is coming from, which honestly, that doesn't make much sense. I may have bought the elevation as a reason they called it Upper Egypt, but since nobody proposes it, I'll keep my money. Another unmistakable similarity is the fact that Memphis, Egypt is located at the head of the Nile Delta. And bitch, you guessed it. Memphis, Tennessee is also located at the head of the Mississippi Delta. To contrast, New Orleans plays the same role as Alexandria, both being the gateway into the inland territories. But the truth of the matter is, Memphis, Tennessee is more Memphis than ancient Memphis could ever be. Ancient Memphis doesn't even exist, and modern Memphis has been in existence for thousands of years and has since always maintained its significance. All these maps that we use are a great resource to understand the parallelisms in history. But one daunting question that always comes to mind when I think about these maps: of all the monuments, statues, and hieroglyphics supposedly demonstrating the superior Egyptian knowledge, why didn't they chisel one map? Not even a single one. They have no engraved maps, and the only remaining map from ancient Egypt is the Turin Papyrus? It wasn't collected until after Memphis, Tennessee had already been named. And bitch, you guessed it again. It had to be discovered by one of Napoleon's boys. But here's the kicker. The Turin Papyrus map is not even accurate or consistent with the supposed scale of Egyptian advancement at the time. These niggas didn't chisel one map into a rock.
Why? 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 Why?
Why not? Does anyone have a good answer to why Egyptians never chiseled one map? And there's only one map remaining? For some niggas who could sculpt a rock, a granite rock, with the accuracy up to a trillimeter, the Egyptians made some pretty shitty maps. Wouldn't you say?
Breaking down some reaper, rolling up a sweeter, riding through the street, cheaping like a heater, reaper got me missile, all they go to blue boy, searching by the ego, breath smell like liquor, man is project fatter, play up from the six out, always pack a dagger, go deep in my missile, hustle for the chitter, trying to make me fitter, you respect the man, or you get some bloody sweater.
Boy, this shit right here looks sloppy as hell, boy. They ain't got no foundations. They just got the statues laying out in the dirt. Like, this is, like, really, they just built this shit with no foundations? I mean, they did all this and just, something don't seem right about this shit. Just, look at this shit here, man. They just toppled like that on top of the dirt like that. That's just how they do. Like, you know, some guys was like, let's move these around. Something, yeah, this shit. Something fugazi about this shit right here, cuz.